Hello, good day. Thank you for tuning in. Welcome to the Canon Online Cardiology Days. My name is Janne Schuif and I'm a clinical research manager at Canon Medical Systems Europe. And today we kick off a series of webinars covering a wide range of topics all related to cardiology. Today's session is called Cardiovascular Disease, an old problem, new ways to look at it. And that is exactly what we intend to do in the next hour. So in this context of challenging the traditional ways of thinking and doing things, I'm very excited to introduce the first speaker of today, Professor Patrick de Boever. Professor Patrick de Boever is a research and innovation manager at the University of Antwerp and also a part-time professor at Hasselt University. And in his work, he is focusing on retinal image analysis using artificial intelligence. So this is not a topic that you traditionally expect at a session on cardiovascular imaging, but we promise to shake things up. So Professor Boever, please go ahead and share your insights on how eye exams can help us in the detection of cardiovascular disease.
Thank you, Joanna, for the nice introduction. So a very good evening to all participants. And it's a real honor to kick off this webinar series as part of the Canon Cardiology Days. And I'd like to thank the organizing committee at Canon for the invitation and to give me the opportunity to give you some insights on how an eye exam can help heart disease detection. So we often say that the eye is the window to the heart. And let me explain this with this rather complicated scheme, but I'll try to walk you through quite quickly. So first of all, on the top, you see some changes, physiological changes that can occur during life and with aging. We all know about the cardiovascular changes like arterial stiffening, impaired function, endothelial function, altered heart function. At the same time, we see hormonal changes like changes in renin and aldosterone that regulate kidney balance and water balance, and also have an influence on the intravascular volume. Thirdly, we also see that the nervous system changes, and we see changes in the autonomic nervous system, baroreflex sensitivity changes, and so on. All these different factors lead to a neurovascular system that gets disturbed because there's a close interaction between the vascular system and the neurological system. And this neurovascular instability, which may be subclinical and first time, will lead to blood pressure variations or orthostatic hypertension, hypotension, changes in heart rate, and so on. And there really a very complex interaction occurs. And this has an impact on an impaired perfusion. So the different tissues get less oxygen, the removal of the CO2 and the waste products becomes more less efficient. We get inflammation and oxidative stress. And this catalyzes also further impaired autoregulation. Autoregulation that has an impact on the local regulation of the blood flow. And all these complex changes, when they accumulate over time, they lead to subclinical and in the end also clinical damage and end organ damage that is being visible or can be detected in the brain, in the heart, and in the eye, as an example. And here you see coming together the eye with the heart. And basically, instead of looking at the heart with maybe very complex techniques, we may also learn more about the cardiovascular system and the microvascular of the heart by looking to the eye. And looking to the eye can be very interesting because it's a very easy and non-convenient technique to tell you something about the microcirculation. And this is really possible because the eye is optically transparent, and so with very easy imaging techniques, we can look to the back of the eye, which is called the retina. And we can do this with different techniques. The most obvious one and the most old one is the classical digital camera. And you can collect an image, the 2D image of the back of the eye. The second analysis is more a dynamic one by looking at the dynamic response of blood vessels. And a third one is a system called optical coherence tomography angiography, which is a newer variant to look at the blood flow. And this allows you to look at much more detail at the microcirculation. Now, there are two ways to analyze retinal images. On the one hand, you can use computer programs. So you learn the computer to analyze specific features that are of interest. On the other hand, we can make use of new machine learning and deep learning to give the computer an enormous amount of images and clinical images and learn to see patterns and clinical patterns. Now, the first one is the more basic one based on the classical computer vision. And so you present the image to computer specialists and informaticians, and they will, using programming, extract microvascular information. So they will extract the information of the microcirculation and the small blood vessels. So these are the microcirculation or the blood vessel pattern that is depicted on the left. And it is during a process called image segmentation. When we have segmented these images, then we can start calculating different features like the widths of vessels, arterial widths, venular widths, or ratios between vessels to get an idea about the dimensions. But we also can extract information linked to the geometric pattern. So we can see how many times these vessels branch, the complexity of the branches, the straightness of the vessels, the curliness of the vessels called tortuosity, or more getting an impression about the complex vessel pattern using fractal dimensions. And so these type of measurements have been used already for a long time to associate microvascular changes, retinal microvascular changes, with different cardiovascular outcomes. And one of the first studies or important studies is a meta-analysis that was published in 2014 that linked really the changes in retinal blood vessels, the arterioles and the venules, the widths of these vessels, with the development of hypertension. So in a study of more than 10,000 participants combining multiple longitudinal cohort studies, the researchers saw that when the arterioles narrow, that this leads to a higher risk, like a 29% risk, higher risk of developing hypertension. And if the venules widened, then this also was linked with an increased cardiovascular risk, or in this case, a risk of developing hypertension. And so this was really predictive because they took the image at the baseline, and then they followed the participants over a period of more than 10 years, and they identified that the width of the retinal vessels at the baseline had a prediction power for hypertension. Now, this was taken further in other studies, and this is a study that was published in 2016, coming from the same type of cohort studies, where they identified that, again, the narrowing of the arterioles, so the vessel width calibers and the wider venules, were linked with different cardiovascular outcomes, going from atherosclerotic cardiovascular events up to different cardiovascular disease endpoints, like heart failure, stroke, and even death caused by cardiovascular disease. So you see that the widening of the venules and the narrowing of the arterioles, there's the box on the top left, it was linked with a higher risk of developing these cardiovascular disease or clinical endpoints. This was a confirmation of previous studies, but then also those researchers went further and they used the widening of the dimensions of the vessels as an additional risk classification marker. And this is what is shown on the right box. So they first calculated the risk score for developing a cardiovascular disease for the different individuals. That is the PCE score. And they classify them according to low risk, medium, or high risk. So less than 5%, between 5 and 7.5, or more than 7.5%. And then they added the information about the vessels. And then they could confirm that when they took into account the vessel widths, that they, especially women, were reclassified to a higher risk. So meaning that the addition of retinal information could reclassify patients or women in this case, healthy women, from a low risk to an intermediate risk. And this may have consequences for the follow-up of those individuals. In parallel, and also a bit later from the same study, they showed, and more in detail, that these wider venules and narrower arterioles were significantly linked with the development of heart failure, and that there was a linear relationship for the arterioles, the Cray value, and that narrower Cray values were induced a high risk, and lower Cray values were conferring risk, and the higher Cray values were more protective. And larger retinal values, venules were linked to a higher risk of heart failure again. And this was also confirmed with other cardiovascular techniques, and they could see the link between the venule widths and different and hypertrophy and worse diastolic and systolic function. Now, for the last part, I would like to focus on deep learning. So there are new techniques that allow you to extract direct information from the retinal images, like cardiovascular risk factors. And here you see two publications that, and especially the first one by Poplin et al., published in Nature Biomedical Engineering, that could predict, just based on a retinal image, a number of cardiovascular risk factors, but also major adverse cardiac events. Now, for this audience, this may be very relevant because in another publication with more than 250,000 retinal images, they were able to make a significant association between information that extracted using deep learning from a fundus image and the calcium arterial calcium score. And so this is really interesting because you can get the same information from a fundus image as you could get from this type of CT scan. And these authors use this new risk score, this rating CAC risk score to classify patients into risk categories. And they identified as those patients could really benefit from having an additional fundus image. Mm. Now, as a last part of the presentation, I would like to focus on two techniques. First of all, dynamic vessel analysis, which is more a dynamic analysis, making use of the neurovascular coupling to study the endothelial function, so the endothelial barrier function. And researchers have shown that when you apply the light stimulus, that the retinal vessels, they enlarge, so they respond to these to this stroboscopic light, and you have a normal reaction. But for example, in the case of disease and hypertension, then this reactivity becomes impaired. And this could be a functional marker for looking at cardiovascular disease risks. Finally, the new technique, OCT angiography, allows you to go to micro-level analysis of the microcirculation. And this very recent review summarizes the results so far. And they identify that both in healthy volunteers as well in patients, that this retinal vessel density and particular metrics linked to this microcirculatory pattern collected with OCTA changes. So this might also be a promising non-invasive technique to analyze the microcirculation of the retina. And to conclude, I hope to have in the short presentation have been able to convince you that eye exams are fast and convenient, less than 5 minutes, that there are different image modalities that give information about structural and functional cardiovascular information, and that there's plenty of information now available that eye exams may have a predictive medical value and may be of use for cardiovascular follow-up and cardiovascular disease management. And so with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor de Boever. Very fascinating, actually, to see how so much information we can get from a quite accessible examination. So very exciting. We will leave questions to the end. And so I would like to move on to the next speaker. And it's a great honor to introduce Dr. Yoko Kato from Johns Hopkins University. So Dr. Kato is a cardiologist who actually moved from the interventional world to non-invasive imaging and is a true expert in both the clinical and technical aspects of cardiac MRI. And today she will discuss the unique capabilities of cardiac MRI for comprehensive risk stratification in patients with cardiovascular disease. So please go ahead, Dr. Kato.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to give a presentation in this wonderful session. My name is Yoko Kato from Johns Hopkins University. The title of my presentation is Cardiac MRI and Coronary MRA for the Risk Stratification in Patients with Cardiovascular Disease. There is no COI to declare. Background. Early detection, treatment, and prognostication of cardiovascular disease, CVD, is crucial in clinical situations. Cardiac MRI is a strong, non-invasive, one-stop-shop modality for the assessment of CVD. This presentation focuses on the utilization of cardiac MRI in the management of CVD. We will discuss techniques of cardiac MRI as well as their accumulated knowledge on the CVD risk stratification and prognostication. So this is a table which presents the cardiac MRI images used for the management of CVD. You can recognize the non-contrast images by the yellow highlight. We can use CINE image to assess cardiac function and strain, a T2-weighted image or T2-MAP image to assess the edema or inflammation, LGE, late gadolinium enhancement for the myocardial scar, which we call replacement fibrosis, and native T1 and ECV, they are used to assess the diffuse interstitial fibrosis. A perfusion image is used to assess the ischemic burden, and coronary MR angiography, which is somewhat experimental, but we use it for the coronary stenosis assessment. And this page shows the two different types of myocardial fibrosis. One is replacement fibrosis, which will be assessed by the LGE image, this type of fibrosis. And another is interstitial fibrosis, which we use T1 mapping images such as native T1 and ECV, this type of fibrosis. And this is a representative case from an ongoing study. It is a case of acute phase anterior STEMI, and on the LGE image, you can see the large scar on the anterior wall, which is a white highlighted high intensity area. And also in the middle of the LGE, there is a MVO dark area, which is a microvascular obstruction, which corresponds to the no reflow phenomenon. And in the right-hand side, it is presented the workstation segmentation of the scar. And there is a gray zone that located at the edge of the LGE, which is a mixture of the healthy myocardium and fibrosis, and which relates to the arrhythmic event post-MI cases. And this is a T2-weighted image, which we assess edema. And especially this is acute phase post-MI case, so that this highlighted area, we call it area at risk. And at the middle of this area at risk, there is a dark area, which is a intramyocardial hemorrhage. And this is another case from the same cohort study. And we can see the images from the acute phase and from the chronic phase. So on the CINE image, we can assess the cardiac wall motion, and there is a diffuse hypokinesis and a kinesis in this case, and we can observe the pericardial effusion as well. At the chronic phase, the effusion has subsided, and the hypokinesis has slightly recovered, but still there is some akinetic wall at the apex. And on the LGE image, you can recognize a large scar with MVO, but at the chronic phase, the MVO has disappeared, and you can see the transmural LGE scar. And you can quantify the LVEF and LGE scar percentage as here. And this is a figure that shows the representative distribution of LGE in ischemic and non-ischemic cases. So in the ischemic cases, we assess the transmurality of the LGE. And depending on the transmurality, we call it subendocardial infarct or the transmural infarct. And this transmurality is very well used in the clinical situation because when the transmurality is less than 50%, we generally consider there is a viability to that wall. And quantification of myocardial scar is quite important for prognostication. And this is a meta-analysis study from 10 randomized trials that assess the infarct size from an acute phase post-MI patients. And the outcome is all-cause mortality or heart failure hospitalization. And they concluded that in every 5% increase in myocardial infarct size on cardiac MRI resulted in 20% increase in the relative hazard ratio for one-year heart failure hospitalization and all-cause mortality. MVO, microvascular obstruction, is a very strong prognostic factor in post-MI patients. So in this meta-analysis, they reported that in patients with microvascular obstruction, there were a higher rate of occurrence of MACE, cardiac death, recurrent MI, and heart failure. Gray zone. Gray zone is another strong prognostic factor, especially to assess the arrhythmic event in post-MI cases. So in this study, they assessed the occurrence of arrhythmic event. It means ICD therapy in this study, and based on the gray zone large amount. And they reported that in cases with larger infarct gray zone amount, there were higher occurrence rate of ICD therapy. Then we would talk about the interstitial fibrosis assessment by native T1 and ECV. And this is a representative image from a chronic MI case. And here in these panels, you can see the LGE scar in the anterior wall. And on the ECV map, you can recognize that the ECV value is quite high at the corresponding location as the LGE scar. And at the same time, ECV map or native T1 map, we can assess the values in the remote myocardium, which is a known scar area. And this study assessed the native T1 value of the remote myocardium at the acute phase post-MI patient on 1.5 Tesla MRI. And please be careful that the native T1 value changes based on the strength of the MRI. And so the value changes between 1.5 Tesla and 3 Tesla. And those patients who presented MACE during the follow-up period had a higher value of native T1 in the remote myocardium when compared to those without MACE. And they identified that when the remote zone native T1 value was higher than this number, there was higher occurrence rate of MACE. Then let's talk about the perfusion image. And myocardial perfusion is generally used for the stable angina in angina patients. And CE mark study, this is a study that reported the better performance of cardiac MRI than the SPECT in detection of significant stenosis confirmed by the angiography. And in the right-hand side, this is a study that compares the performance of cardiac MRI, a perfusion-based revascularization strategy, to FFR-based revascularization. And they assessed the one-year event-free survival. And they reported that event-free survival was comparable between these two strategies. Then we will talk about the coronary MR angiography. This is somewhat experimental, but very interesting images. And these are the images that were acquired at our lab. We use Canon Galen 3 Tesla cardiac MRI. And this was a case with significant stenosis at the middle of the LAD. So you can recognize the signal intensity drop at the corresponding location to the stenosis. And in the right-hand side, this is another different case from this one, but we compared the MRCA to the coronary CT. And on the coronary CT image, you can recognize the two lesions with calcified plaque. And on the MRCA, we can see the signal intensity drop. And when we draw the signal intensity profile curve along the center line of this MRCA, so this is a profile curve, we can clearly recognize the signal intensity drop in this corresponding location to the lesions, two lesions. And this is the last topic in this presentation, the assessment of vulnerable plaque on the cardiac MRI. And this paper tried to assess the plaque characteristics on cardiac MRI using the T1 weighted image, we call it MP rate. And they have identified that the vulnerable plaque is recognized as high intensity plaque on this image. And they compared this image to coronary MRA and as well as coronary CT. And they reported that the same location presented the signal intensity drop on the MRCA. And on the CTA, there was a significant stenosis with large plaque burden as well as the calcification. And they assessed the plaque to myocardium signal intensity ratio, which we call PMR. And when the PMR was over 1.4, it was an independent predictor of coronary events. And discussion. Optimization of the MRI protocol that provides enough information in each individual cases is important in clinical situations. There are multiple experimental but promising MRI techniques to assess CVD. Utilization and wider adoptions of them in clinical situations are expected. This is the conclusion. Cardiac MRI is a strong non-invasive modality for the management of CVD. This is my acknowledgments, and this is our Lima lab. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kato. Excellent talk. So with that, I would like to move on to the third speaker of today, Dr. Michelle Williams. She's a senior clinical lecturer and radiology consultant at the University of Edinburgh. She's particularly well known for her work in cardiac CT, a frequent speaker at many conferences, and one of the main investigators of the famous Scott Hart trial. And today she will share her insights on how we can use CT to optimize care for women. So, Dr. Williams, we're very happy that you're also joining us today. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much indeed, Joanne. It's fantastic to be here today. So I'm going to be talking about the similarities and differences that we can elucidate from CT in terms of coronary artery disease between the two sexes. First, a disclosure slide. And so we're going to talk about coronary artery disease, and we're going to talk about myocardial infarction, similarities and differences. So, cardiovascular disease, let's start with the basics. It remains the leading cause of death around the world for all sexes and for women in particular. More women die of cardiovascular disease than of breast cancer, and one in 16 women over the age of 20 years old have coronary heart disease. When it comes to cardiovascular risk factors, the interesting things is all the usual risk factors are relevant, but some of them are particularly relevant in women. So research has shown that hypertension, smoking, diabetes, obesity, hyperlipidemia, depression and stress, chemotherapy and breast cancer treatment in particular, and autoimmune diseases all have particularly acute impact in women compared to men. And then there's the sex-specific risk factors. Things like hormonal dysregulation, premature menopause or primary ovarian insufficiency, adverse pregnancy outcomes, gestational diabetes, breast cancer and all the associated treatments. And all of these things we need to think about when we think about differences between the sexes in terms of cardiovascular risk factors. Now, for a long time, we thought that cardiovascular disease presented differently in women. And there's the adage in all of the textbooks still that women present more likely with atypical symptoms. Increasingly, we're realizing this isn't true. So this is a research study from Edinburgh by one of our research nurses, Amy Ferry, who looked at all of the chest pain patients coming to the accident emergency department and classified their symptoms according to whether they were men or women and whether they had myocardial infarction as the ultimate diagnosis or not. And these beautiful diagrams show you some of the similarities and differences when it comes to the symptoms that patients presented with. When it comes to those who had myocardial infarction, there was no differences in the symptoms between men and women. So we really need to start thinking about some of these things in terms of similarities, rather than just always thinking about the differences. An important thing to mention when we're talking about myocardial infarction and differences between sex is MANOCA, myocardial infarction without obstructive coronary artery disease. Now, this presents in 1 in 4% of acute myocardial infarctions, and it's more common in women, particularly those less than 50 years old. There's a variety of different causes for this, spontaneous coronary artery dissection, vasospastic angina, Takotsubo's, myocarditis, microvascular ischemia, and other causes that we haven't yet elucidated. So, what can CT tell us? Well, the first and most important thing for me is the use of CT has moved us on from thinking about risk factors and symptoms to thinking about actually what disease is there. So on a non-contrast CT, we can see coronary artery calcification, like on the left. And on a contrast-enhanced CT coronary angiogram, we can see the presence of stenosis, but we can also see the characteristics of the atherosclerotic plaque itself. And that's things like, how much is there? Is it calcified or non-calcified? Are there any high-risk plaque features? What's the distribution? And then more advanced things like radiomics and pericoronary adipose tissue attenuation. So CT can really open the door to this assessment of coronary artery disease. 50 years ago, Hounsfield did his first CT scans back in 1971. And in his Nobel acceptance speech, he did say that a further promising use would be the assessment of the coronary arteries. He was an incredible person, but I'm not sure he could have anticipated quite the amazing range of things that we can really see now in the coronary arteries. So what can we see? And what are the differences and the similarities? Let's start with asymptomatic patients. So when it comes to asymptomatic patients, consistently across all of the different research studies, we know that women in these cohorts have less coronary artery calcification than men. So this is graphs from the CAT consortium study. And the image on the figure on the left shows the proportion of women and men with a calcium score greater than zero. And you can see men, the green line is above the blue line. But the really interesting thing is where there's an inflection point, where there's a change from just going along the way to an increase in that graph. And that inflection point is at 46 years in women and 37 years in men, roughly a 10-year difference in the development and progression of coronary artery disease. Now, when we look at outcomes in this study, amongst patients with no coronary artery calcification, the outcomes are very similar between men and women. However, in patients with detectable coronary artery calcium score, the women in this study did worse than the men. What about CT coronary angiography? Well, this study has just been published that looks at 25,000 people in Sweden. They had no history of coronary artery disease and they had CT coronary angiography, and 42% of them had evidence of coronary artery disease. Similar to all the previous cohorts that have been assessed with looking at this, men had more coronary artery disease and more severe coronary artery disease. But the really interesting thing in this study for me is that, again, we see a 10-year delay in the onset of the obstructive and the severe coronary artery disease between men and women. A similar pattern of disease was seen at 50 to 54 years in men, but 60 to 64 years in women. And that idea of a 10-year delay in the generation, a development of this disease between men and women in asymptomatic populations is really starting to emerge. This is a beautiful diagram from that paper, which shows you an important point. The pattern of coronary artery disease was similar between men and women. It was just more frequent in men. So men are on the left, with a darker red being more prevalent disease, and women are on the right-hand side. So you can see similar patterns, just more prevalent in men and occurring at a younger age. So what about symptomatic patients? So when it comes to symptomatic patients, the first study I'm going to talk about is the Scott Heart trial. So this was a randomized control trial run here in Scotland with Professor Newby as the chief investigator. We recruited 4,146 patients, and half had the standard of care and half had a CT coronary angiogram added to their care. So these were all symptomatic patients who attended the rapid access chest pain clinic or cardiology outpatient clinics. And we showed that patients who had CT scan guided management had a change in their diagnosis in 25%, a change in their investigations in 15%, and a change in their treatment in 23%. And at 5 years of follow-up, we found that there was a halving in the rate of fatal or non-fatal myocardial infarction in patients who had their management guided by CT coronary angiography. More recently, we've gone on to have a look at a whole pile of different things on their CT scans in terms of their cardiovascular risk. And one of them is the quantitative plaque assessment. So whole heart quantitative plaque assessment of all of the different types of plaque. And we found that low attenuation plaque in particular was predictive of adverse outcomes. So patients with a high burden of low attenuation plaque above 4% were 5 times more likely to suffer fatal or non-fatal myocardial infarction. And this is an example of that low attenuation plaque on the CT coronary angiogram here. When it comes to the Scott Heart study, there are differences in the cardiovascular risk factors in the women and men. And these are similar to many of the cohorts that have been studied before. Women had a slightly higher BMI, slightly more smoking history, slightly higher cholesterol, overall slightly lower cardiovascular risk, but less history of coronary artery disease previously. So a range of cardiovascular risk factors that are different between the men and the women. When it comes to the disease on the CT scan, first of all, calcium score, we can see that there's a big difference in the number of patients with normal CT calcium scores between the men and women. 51% of the women had a calcium score of zero, 25% of the men had a calcium score of zero. Men, however, were more likely to have calcium score above 100, above 400, and above 1,000. When we split the CT coronary angiograms into normal, non-obstructive disease, and obstructive disease, women were more likely to have normal coronary arteries and men were more likely to have obstructive coronary artery disease. Looking at the quantitative plaque assessment, men were more likely to have plaque of all of the different types. So they had a larger burden of total plaque, calcified plaque, non-calcified plaque, and low attenuation plaque. And one of the things we did was look at just the patients who had heart attacks subsequently on follow-up. It's a small number, it's only 50, but it's a really interesting cohort because between the men and the women in those who actually went on to have heart attacks at some point during that 5 years of follow-up, there wasn't any difference in the plaque constituents between men or between women. So this highlights a really interesting a challenge that we're seeing here. Women have less plaque, but if they do have plaque, they're at just as high a risk as the men. And here's an example of that CT coronary angiogram I showed you earlier and where they had their myocardial infarction 4 years later, proved on invasive angiography at the same position. When it comes to the predictive ability, low attenuation plaque has an AUC of 0.68 for men and 0.77 for women. No statistically significant difference between those curves, but the women one is slightly higher there on the images. So it's just as good at predicting outcomes in men as in women. In a multivariable analysis looking at these different things, the low attenuation plaque burden was an independent predictor, independent over the presence of stenosis, sex, and cardiovascular risk scores. So what about some other studies? So the PROMISE trial looked at 10,000 patients at similar sort of time to Scott Hart and randomly assigned them to either CT scan or functional testing. Similarly, in the Scott Hart, they showed that men were more likely to have an abnormal CT coronary angiogram. They also were more likely to have an abnormal stress nuclear scan, but they were less likely to have an abnormal exercise tolerance test, which makes me worry about exercise tolerance tests even more than I currently do. Women were found to derive more prognostic information from the CT coronary angiogram, whereas men derived equal prognostic information from both CT coronary angiogram and the stress test. And when they looked at high-risk plaques, they found that they were of increased predictive ability in women and in younger people in particular. And finally, just a word on plaque progression. So the PARADIGM study has an amazing cohort of patients who've had CT scans at more than one time point. And so they can look at the progression and differences in progression between men and women. And they found that women had less total and non-calcified plaque burden at baseline, similar to the Scott Hart trial. But on follow-up imaging, they found that there was slower progression of total and non-calcified plaque in the women, but similar progression of the calcified plaque volume. So this tells us that it's not just about the amount of plaque, it's about the change in plaque over time as well. So in conclusion, there are similarities and there are differences between men and women in terms of coronary artery disease, and CT scans can help us understand that in more detail. Women have less plaques of all types. There's a 10-year delay in this developing the CT findings of coronary artery disease. Women have slower progression of non-calcified plaque and total plaque, but similar progression of calcified plaque. And really importantly, women who have subsequent myocardial infarction have the same plaque burdens compared to the men. And low attenuation plaque is just as good a predictor of outcomes in men and women. So thank you very much indeed for having me here today, and I look forward to the questions at the end.
Thank you very much, Dr. Williams. It's great to see how looking at men versus women, we actually learn more about the disease and how CT and plaque can help us. And speaking of plaque burden and atherosclerosis, it's time to move on to the final speaker of today. That's Dr. Armin Zadeh, again from Johns Hopkins University. So Dr. Zadeh is a very experienced academic cardiologist and researcher and has been involved in the CORE 64, CORE 320 trials. And his work and practice truly centers around looking at what is actually causing disease, treating disease rather than temporarily fixing manifestations of disease. So with that, in the next 12 minutes, he will give his perspective on how patients with coronary artery disease should be managed, and also with particular attention to the potential role of ultra high resolution CT in this context. So Dr. Zadeh, please go ahead.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Skoyf, for this kind introduction, and thank you for the opportunity to be part of this exciting event and part of this list of esteemed speakers this afternoon. So it's my pleasure to talk about a potential role of ultra-high resolution CT as a cornerstone for the contemporary evaluation and management of stable angina. I do have disclosures. Research support from Canon Medical System. So let me start with a case presentation. A 52-year-old woman with history of hypertension comes to your office. So it's a very common scenario. I'm sure you encounter a lot in your practice. Atypical chest pain. She's mildly obese on exam. Her ECG is normal. Lipids are on target for risk profile. Echo is normal. And she's overall of intermediate predisposability for coronary heart disease. So the question is, you know, what we're going to do for testing. And I would submit to you that there are still many providers would still order a stress test as the first line of testing. And as Dr. Williams alluded to, the evidence for this becomes less and less solid. In fact, there's a lot of evidence now to the contrary. Now, overall, what we have to think about is in this is a situation, how we improve the patient's outcome. And in order to do that, we have to address the one of the biggest questions in cardiology for many years and even decades. Now, what is it what drives patients' outcome? Is it the coronary anatomy or is it myocardial ischemia? And the good news is, that there is a clear-cut answer right now. So this question is settled. There's no more dispute. There shouldn't be any more dispute. So this is data from the ischemia study, which was just, this analysis was just published a few weeks ago, and then shows you the outcome of patients in ischemia. And as you know, these are patients, higher risk patients referred for cardiac catheterization with coronary heart disease. So you're looking at here at mortality, myocardial infarction, cardiovascular death, combined endpoint, according to whether patients had severe, moderate, or non or mild myocardial ischemia. And you see here plotted whether they, according to these criteria, were at higher risk or lower risk for the endpoints. And you see on the side here the p-values. What you can really easily see is that there is essentially zero evidence that myocardial ischemia, the severity of myocardial ischemia, drives any of these outcomes. It's essentially just very close to the line of identity of to one here. And the p-values are all non-significant. So it's a key realization or take home message, I should say, that ischemia, myocardial ischemia, induced myocardial ischemia, what we do, how we do it with stress testing, does not matter for patient outcome. It does not. And this is against a lot of thinking or at least teaching for many years. But the evidence is very clear and consistent. It does not matter for patient outcome. What does matter for patient outcome is shown in the other analysis in this presentation. And they looked here at the similar outcomes, mortality, myocardial infarction, or these endpoints according to whether the patients had restricted or limited coronary heart disease, meaning like a one vessel disease versus the two vessel disease, three vessel disease, or extensive three vessel disease or left main disease. Now, for these analysis, you can see that patients who had only limited coronary heart disease were at lowest risk, whereas the more disease they had, the greater the risk. Very consistently, and this is something we've been knowing for many years, that what drives the patient outcome largely is the atherosclerotic disease burden. So this is the triangle of acute coronary syndrome risk. And again, atherosclerotic disease burden drives the risk. And then there's atherosclerotic disease activity. Obviously, if you have a lot of plaque progression, then you're also of greater risk. And then thirdly, importantly, often somewhat neglected is the prothrombotic milieu. You need to have, the more risk factors you have for thrombosis, such as diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, et cetera, the greater your risk, particularly associated with these other factors. So importantly, again, as Dr. Williams pointed out, stress testing does not assess any of these critical things. Now, what does stress testing do? It detects disease at a later stage. And as she showed you here from Promise and Scott had, there's direct evidence that if you use an atomic guided strategy versus stress testing, in this case, what I'm looking at is specifically the heart endpoints, non-fatal myocardial infarction hazard ratio or death or myocardial infarction hazard ratio. And again, in the key thing in PROMISE was that it was widely perceived as a neutral study. But if you look at actually non-fatal MI hazard ratio, actually it was lower. It was 23% reduced in PROMISE, but it was not statistically significant. Why? Because PROMISE was vehemently underpowered. It was too short of a follow-up, too low of a risk population. They assumed an 8% event rate at the conclusion of their study, but they found a 3% event rate. promise was vehemently underpowered, could not show any difference. That's very important to keep in mind, but they did show the same trend as we saw in all other studies. And you go out to this larger Danish registry, 86,000 patients. And in there, you see a highly significant 29% risk reduction for myocardial infarction and also significantly reduced death or myocardial infarction. Then, you know, as Dr. Williams showed, Scottard went even further out, 58 months, and it is a higher risk population. And so they were able to show a 40% risk reduction for non-fatal myocardial infarction, really an astounding result. And why is it? Because again, Dr. Williams showed you, their patients were identified early in the process as having an atherosclerotic disease, and the treatment, preventative treatment, was initiated. And that cannot be done unless you see the disease, and the stress test does not allow you to see the disease itself. And that's why we have advocated strongly for CT to be the first line test in patients with stable angina, because it's very effective in risk stratification. If you have no atherosclerosis disease, and these are symptomatic patients, and there's still about one third of patients you see in your practices have no atherosclerosis. These are patients who need lifestyle modifications, but they don't need any specific preventative measures. They are exceedingly low risk. And then there are those patients who do have atherosclerotic disease, and they need varying degree of medical therapy, you know, likely more intensive for those who have more extensive atherosclerotic disease. Now, the remaining big question is, you know, who are the patients who still in these days will benefit from coronary artery revascularization, a patient's stable disease? And that is something we don't know after ischemia, because ischemia did not show any benefit in the subgroups, even for diabetics, which came out this week. So ischemia, though, excluded patients with left main disease. So we still believe left main disease probably warrants revascularization, but that is, there's no direct evidence anymore for this with contemporary medical therapy. But that is a group is still thinking revascularization is adequate. Those with low EF, probably based on a stitch trial. But anything else, we really don't have any strong evidence to push for revascularization. In the absence of intolerable angina, obviously some patients have intolerable angina and they're getting, you know, revascularization for symptomatic relief. Now, there is one big issue though. CT is quite good for these assessment, except in the higher risk category. CT has not been used much. You know, CT is mostly used in the lower risk category. In the higher risk category, there's a big issue. And that is that patients who have extensive coronary disease often have also extensive coronary calcification. And in the presence of coronary artery calcification, the accuracy, the diagnostic accuracy for CT, you know, drops quite dramatically. This is our own data from course 64. You see patients with a calcium score under or over 600. And you see, again, a dramatic drop in accuracy, particularly in specificity. And, you know, you would say, like, well, the data is somewhat old, but, you know, this is still 64 slice technology, which is, you know, essentially widely used. And but even in core 320, we look at the same and we found the same, that meaning that the higher the calcium score, the lower the accuracy. So this holds pretty much true till today. And the reason for that is the limited spatial resolution and the over representation of the calcium in the reconstruction algorithm. And that's largely due to limited spatial resolution. So we were very excited, you know, to have the first ultra high resolution CT scanner installed in the US a couple of years ago. And so we've been doing a clinical study, a pilot study, to test the hypothesis that ultra high resolution CT is particularly useful in patients with severe coronary artery calcification. This is a pilot study which was published, and there are only 15 patients, but all of them had essentially extensive calcium. The average score was 1200. So these are patients with severe coronary artery calcification, and you know, referred for cardiac catheterization because of suspected coronary artery disease. And we found actually quite high sensitivity and specificity. This is a vessel-based analysis compared to conventional angiography. much greater than you would expect in this, again, this very challenging population with severe coronary calcification. These results are quite encouraging that, you know, CT, particularly using ultra high resolution technology, can overcome the limitation of severe coronary calcification. I show you some examples, imaging examples. So on the left, this is conventional reconstructed CT. You see a plaque in the left main, which looks somewhat concerning, particularly in this location. But on the right, the ultra high resolution CT image showed, you know, the lumen is well preserved. It's not severe. Here again, the same patient in a different projection with a plaque in the left main. Again, you see the concern, but you know, the ultra high resolution CT shows you that the lumen is preserved. And there's another example I'd like to show you before I wrap up. 52-year-old man, 2700 calcium score, you know, young man, fairly young man with the familial hyperlipidemia, extensive calcium everywhere, particularly LAD. This is a curved MPR view of the LAD with conventional CT. The patient was sent for cardiac cath with a diagnosis of severe LAD disease. The patient, but also prior to cardiac catheterization for research purposes, underwent ultra high resolution CT, and you see the corresponding image of the LAD, and you see that the calcium is much more confined here, and you see a more lumen compared to conventional CT. In fact, based on this assessment, we felt that the LAD is not severely stenosed, and that there was only a moderate stenosis, but less than 50%, and that we would not have sent this patient for cardiac catheterization based on these results. But the patient went for, you know, clinically driven cardiac catheterization. You see an image of the LAD here, and you see, and I think you can appreciate, you see all that calcium before the dye comes in, but you can appreciate that the LAD is not severely stenosed. So these are very exciting results in our mind, because again, they may allow us to finally push invasive corneal angiography as the main diagnostic tool for coronary heart disease. So, in conclusions, the outcome of patients with coronary artery disease largely depends on the presence and extent of coronary atherosclerosis and not on inducible ischemia, a key take-home message here. CT yields superior risk stratification and better patient outcome compared to stress testing, and should be the first-line test for the evaluation of most patients with suspected coronary artery disease. And then lastly, ultra-high-resolution CT appears promising for overcoming the limitation of conventional CT in patients with severe coronary artery calcification, and thus may finally render invasive angiography unnecessary in most instances. So with that, I'm very happy to close, and thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zadeh. Fantastic overview and also beautiful images. So with that, I would like to invite the other speakers to open up their cameras again and join the Q&A session. Thank you. So, and our first question is actually to Professor Boever. So there's a question on what kind of requirements, like technical, patient-related, are needed for the images to be used in the deep learning algorithm?
Okay, excellent question, and very interesting, because there's a lot to do about artificial intelligence these days, especially in medicine. First of all, you need a huge amount of data. So this is really big data science, where the more images you have, the better. So we are talking about hundreds of thousands of images, clinical images that needs to be used to first of all train the algorithms. And secondly, also to test and validate these algorithms, because you first learn the computer to see a pattern, but then obviously you need to verify that the computer does the correct learning. So you need a lot of images. And then secondly, you have to have a very diverse data set, both from healthy individuals, patients with a mild disease, probably, and then severe disease. So because the computer will learn to see the patterns, it's important that to see that, to know that the computer needs to learn across the entire spectrum of disease states, and so that it does not get a biased view. So a large amount of data and for a diverse population set and balanced. So not patient groups with few images and the other with a large group. So the data sets need to be balanced. And then finally, in terms of technical requirements, you would like to see that your algorithm or the analysis of the algorithm holds true in different systems and different modalities. So basically, you would like to make sure that also your data sets or at least your validations occur on different types of camera types or instruments, maybe also from different vendors to make sure that you can generalize the findings in clinics. And that's exactly the challenge that we are facing in artificial intelligence in medicine. There's a lot of very nice research and very hopeful and promising research about very good algorithms with a high prediction power. But basically the challenge is now to make the translation to the clinic and to the applicability. And to take it from the research actually to the use in practice.
That was indeed going to be my follow-up question. So indeed tackling also the different systems and how to actually make sure that you can apply it in clinical practice. Do you have an estimate of like the time frame that you think that this will come to clinical reality?
Well, actually, it is all already clinical reality. So there are already many different companies and startup companies that use artificial intelligence in some way in the decision making. That can go from image processing, so more like improving the quality of the image and the reliability of the image. So that also is a space where artificial intelligence can be used. But then when it comes to clinical decision-making and artificial intelligence, well, there are already companies, especially in the field of ophthalmology, where it's being used, for example, to screen in primary care for diabetic retinopathy, where it's already operational. But for the broad clinical application and in the different disciplines, I think it's going to still last for another 5 years or so, because we really see this as emerging, because there was this initial hype in AI, but now people also would like to see a bit more confirmation about the actual use of it, also in context of a regulatory framework and the responsibility, for example. And what happens if the computer starts to make a decision? What does that mean for the managing doctor, for example?
The whole black box that people are still
exactly in. The whole black box. So you would like. So there's this European legislation that states that the patient has the right to have an insight in how the decision was made. But of course, if the algorithm just spits out a number. Without knowing how the computer actually came to that decision, that might be a problem in some cases. So there's still a lot of research also needed in this field, and we need to develop a better regulatory framework to deal with this new kind of technology. But it's definitely part of the future.
Valid, I think, across all applications. So I'm wondering actually what the cardiac-oriented imagers think of the retinal image analysis. Dr. Michelle Williams, any thoughts? Do you see this also emerging in your research?
Yeah, I find it very interesting. So retinal imaging is something that we did in the Scott Hart study as well. And it's a data set that Tom McGilvery and Gavin Robertson did a lot of work on in the past. It's really interesting in terms of what it shows. These are very small blood vessels in the eyes. And in terms of stroke prediction and microvascular disease, I can see the similarities in the disease, and particularly things like hypertension, that all fits together. For me, I'm very interested in epicardial coronary artery disease and myocardial infarction. And I'm not seeing the same sort of patterns. which is really interesting. So I think it's something that needs a lot more research to be done in it. And it's one that over the 10 years that I've been involved in rectal imaging stuff, the technology keeps advancing quite rapidly. So I think there's lots more interesting stuff to come out of it, but probably more in the stroke and microvascular disease rather than in the epicardial coronary artery disease, but I may be proved wrong.
No, the thing is, it did exactly things. Different things predict also different outcomes and different pathways. So it will be very interesting to see. And actually, it's a perfect segue to one of the next questions. And so we had a lot of discussion actually that we're more focusing on epicardial disease. So does it mean that, for instance, stress rest MRI is no longer crucial to be part of an MRI examination? How is perfusion imaging? How does this fit in? Maybe a question for Dr. Kato?
Yeah, thank you so much for this very interesting question. So based on the ischemia study, we could be less confident about applying those perfusion, stress perfusion, but actually there are still some cases that stress perfusion is quite important, such as microvascular dysfunction cases or those with cardiomyopathy, such as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Those cases, I would like to use the stress perfusion that test, so that still there is some important situation that we would like to apply that stress perfusion test.
Thank you very much. So I have another question for Dr. Williams. It was about the studies between men and women. Did you also consider the influence of that men generally later go to a doctor than a woman?
That is a really interesting question and quite an important one. And when it comes to the asymptomatic populations, one of the interesting things that they're doing in some of these Scandinavian cohorts is randomly inviting people based on census data so that they get a true population basis. So I think there's going to be lots of important stuff that we can learn about from those types of studies that in the asymptomatic patients invite as many women as many men. In terms of whether men and women come to the doctor at different rates, in the Scott Hart study, there was a similar number of men and a similar number of women. So I do wonder whether that advice about if you've got chest pain, see a doctor, is starting to get through to people. So it's definitely something that we may see disease later in men because they come to the hospital later. But when you look at that, it's not really the pattern that we've seen within our data. I think it's different around the world in terms of those interactions with the healthcare system as well. So it's an important thing to bear in mind.
Oh, excellent. So I think also, does it mean that in terms of the utilization of CTA, in your practice, you don't see an underutilization of CT in women versus men?
No, we did a national study with the British Society of Cardiovascular Imaging just recently that showed that men and women had the same frequency of having CT coronary angiography requested for them after an appointment at the chest pain clinic where there were similar rates of men and women attending. And the interesting thing is what happened after the scans, and women did seem to have less in the way of downstream management compared to men, even though even accounting for a difference in the disease pattern. So I think we've definitely dealt with the if you've got symptoms, come to the hospital, and we've definitely dealt with our UK guidelines is CT coronary angiography is the first line treatment, and that seems to be happening equally in the sexes. But there do seem to be differences in the how the results are dealt with afterwards. So that's the next thing we need to deal with and work on, I think, to make sure that management is equitable across the sexes.
So really the interpretation and the follow-up, that is still some work to do. Dr. Zadeh, how is that in your practice?
Well, the question is, how should it be and what is it? Unfortunately, we still don't see the numbers coming for coronary CTA than we would like to. And for the reasons for that are, you know, it's complex. You know, what a lot of this is political and economical reasons. And that's very frustrating to us because the data is so overwhelmingly I believe, favoring an anatomic approach, as we discussed. And you know, I don't see any patterns, but I have to say I have not looked closely into the patterns of female versus male referrals. Just the impression is that actually getting more women referred for coronary CTA than men. And I guess the thought behind it is just that referring physicians, they have a lower threshold sending men for cardiac catheterization with the idea or with the thought that they are more likely to have, you know, obstructive coronary disease. But the bigger issue is really we need to see more patients coming as a first-line test CT assessment, and that's still not quite where we like it to be. The US guidelines, ACCHA guidelines, are going to come up in a few days, and widely anticipated to give CT a stronger boost as a class one indication for the assessment of patients with stable chest pain. We're way behind the UK. They did it in 2016. You know, almost 5 years ago they updated the guidelines. So we are lagging behind, which is it's desperately needed a bigger push to support CT as a first line test.
Curious what the new guidelines will bring. So we also have a question on. So one of the main discussion points always with ultra high resolution CT is, how difficult is it to deal with dose and with motion? Can you give a little bit of comment on your experience with that?
Well, yeah, I know, I'm happy to. So the doses, the radiation dose is not much different from conventional CT. It's quite comparable. Maybe like a tick, a little. In our study, it was higher radiation dose because we used a research protocol, an extended exposure window, because we wanted to use the images also to do some advanced computational flow dynamic modeling, which is not required for standard clinical CTA. So that's why our doses in this pilot were a little higher. But if you just restricted them to what we typically do, prospective triggering with a small exposure window, radiation doses were not, really slightly above what we would see with conventional CT. Now, the current iteration of the ultra high resolution CT has a coverage which is, you know, comparable with a 64 slice scanner, which for us, because we used to have a wide detector scanner, was, you know, an adjustment again. But you know, in these days, you know, heart rate control is so much easier with the addition of nivolumab, using a combination of metoprolol and nivolumab, and we're achieving good heart rate control in 90%+ of patients. And that's really what matters. If you get good heart rate control, you have no issues with motion, you get good images on low dose. If you don't have good heart rate control, obviously then everything is off. But you know, I feel like, you know, all patients with meticulous preparation, you can achieve good heart rate control.
Very encouraging to hear. I have a question for Dr. Kato. To segment scar in the late gadolinium enhanced images using deep learning, should we need to combine magnitude and PSNR sequences, or should we process train them separately?
I assume that this is PSIR's image and combining the magnitude and PSIR, I assume. So, first, I'm not the specialist of this segmentation using deep learning. I have a lot of experience on this segmentation, scar segmentation, but it is not using the deep learning for my work. But in my opinion, when the PSIR and magnitude image is acquired with a correct inversion time, then the scar amount should be assessed correctly, so that in that case those images could be combined and processed together. So that's my opinion.
Thank you. Another question is, so you showed actually beautiful images, interesting images on non-contrast coronary MRA. And then I think also in combination with the signal intensity, you have very elegant way of looking at stenosis. So even though maybe at this point still experimental, do you see that this will become available for certain patient populations? Where do you see this go?
Yeah, thank you so much for the question. So it is a very interesting image, and we have been working on it for a while. And so the mechanism of the signal intensity drop is not only the stenosis. So it depends on the what the stenosis comes from. For example, when there is a calcification, there is a signal intensity drop, as well as the severe stenosis, it causes the turbulence of the flow. So that could be another reason for the signal intensity drop. So actually, there is a paper that tries to identify the threshold for the significant stenosis, but still it is somewhat experimental. And one limitation at this point is the spatial resolution. So still the MRCA image cannot achieve the good resolution as the coronary CT. So that's what we need to still work on to improve.
Thank you very much. So we already passed overhead our time. So unfortunately, we've come to the end of today. I would like to thank the speakers, also the audience, for participating. I hope everyone enjoyed this as much as I did. And I look forward to hopefully see you tomorrow, same time, where we will put theory to practice and have a session about productivity. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.
Have a nice day or evening. Bye.